How to kill the Panzerkampfwagen 5 Panther. For this we look at visuals, the Panther of the Panzermuseum Munster and the Panther G-Turret fragment of the Militärhistorische Museum der Bundeswehr Dresden, which both invited me several times in the past. Both the Tiger and Panther tanks had quite a fearsome reputation among Allied soldiers. Particularly for the British, the historian John Buckley notes, Montgomery's views on sustaining morale were such that, expressly for the purposes of boosting the resolve of tank crews, he stamped very quickly and publicly on reports that began to circulate in June 1944, which claimed that Allied tanks were quite outclassed. The reports were of an alarmist nature, as he put it, and he openly stated that the Allies had no difficulties dealing with Tigers and Panthers. He continues that Montgomery and his senior staff were well aware of the reality, however, and at the same time as downplaying the crisis, they were pushing hard for even greater numbers of 17-pounder equipped tanks and sabot ammunition to be introduced to alleviate the difficulties. Although both these big cats are often mentioned in the same sentence, it is very important that these were quite different tanks. Which for some might not be so obvious. By the way, if you want to know how to get rid of the Tiger, be sure to check out my video on how to do that. Back to the differences between the two felines. First, the obvious one. The Panther has sloped armor, whereas the Tiger has basically none. Second, as such, the effective frontal armor of the Panther is thicker than that of the Tiger, whereas the Tiger has a considerably stronger side and rear armor than the Panther, as you can clearly see. This was also noted by the British School of Tank Technology on their pamphlet Attack on Panther Panzerkampfwagen 5 and Tiger Panzerkampfwagen 6 from April 1944. It notes on the armor layout of the Panther, the armor on this tank is out of balance, the hull front being a very strong and the turret front being an awkward target, but all the other plates on the tanks have only a moderate resistance. It follows therefore that the flanks and rear of this tank should be engaged whenever possible. It should be noted however that a lucky hit at quite long ranges low down on the turret front may result in a ricochet through the roof of the hull. The difference between the Tiger and Panther becomes even more obvious if we look at the polar diagrams printed in the German Tiger and Panther primers regarding the T-34 with the 76mm gun. The red areas show where the armor of the respective tank can be penetrated by the T-34's gun. As you can see, the Panther is basically impenetrable from the front for the 76mm gun, yet only in an area of an arc of about 70 to 80 degrees at the front. Once the T-34 gets to the sides, the Panther can be penetrated even at 2000 meters. Meanwhile, for the Tiger, the T-34 is not a threat at 2000 meters, even directly from behind or at the side. As such, the threat area for the Tiger is a weird looking clover leaf, whereas for the Panther it is a pie shape. This of course made the Panther far more vulnerable to flanking. Yet there are many ways to skin a cat. So let us look at the British and Soviet ways to do that. So we look at the Soviet pamphlet Vulnerable Parts of the German Panther Tank and Methods of Combat Against It from 1943, the British Secret Armor Branch Report on Armor Quality and Vulnerability of the Panzerkampfwagen 5 Panther from 1944, and the Comprehensive Firing Trials against the German Panther Panzerkampfwagen 5 from 1945. In these tests, all kind of weaponry was used, like small arms, artillery, anti-tank guns, and mines. Particularly interesting are the vulnerabilities to artillery and direct fire high explosive shells. Let us start with the British sources. One interesting aspect was the use of airburst artillery shells. The idea was that the fragments would penetrate the rather weak protector at the top behind the turret and damage the radiator. The report from 1935 notes regarding the 25-pounder high explosive airburst. Round 1 detonating 10 feet in front of the forward louvres failed to penetrate the radiators. Round 2 detonating 11 feet in front caused several perforations in forward and rear radiators. The loss of water would have caused overheating and ultimate stoppage. Another round resulted in Round 3, detonating 6 feet in front of the forward louvres caused extensive damage to the forward left-hand radiator, with consequent free leakage of water. The remaining radiators were not further damaged. Ultimate stoppage of the engine would have been caused by this attack. It should be noted that quite an elaborate setup was used to achieve these airbursts for the trials. This raises the question how easy or difficult it was to achieve such a hit under combat conditions. Note that the ramp was there to simulate the correct inclination of the projectile fired from a combat distance. And it seems that these tests were not far off, since we know that in December 1944 the Germans authorized protective covers, to quote Jens, as an expedient to increase protection against strafing aircraft and splinters from artillery shells. Steel covers were installed over the air intake and exhaust louvres on the rear deck. As such, it seems to indicate that there were enough problems or at least enough concern about this threat from the German side. Probably the most interesting aspect for some of you might be the following recommendation. The hull and turret front provide, as they are specifically designed to do, a high degree of protection to attack from current British tank and anti-tank weapons firing APCBC, shot or high explosive shell. Accordingly, head-on attack, except with high explosive shell, should be avoided where possible. So the question is, how did they come to that recommendation? Now it is important to mention here that they refer not to the regular high explosive shell of a tank or anti-tank gun, but to that of the 25-pounder artillery gun, which had a caliber of 88mm. Additionally, it is important that the detonation happens within 12 inches, so 0.3 meters above the hull, since this would result in extensive dishing of the roof plate and in considerable admission of blast below the escape doors. There is little doubt that the driver and the co-driver would become casualties. Luckily, we also have information for a more regular caliber high explosive shell, since in a later trial also 75mm high explosive shells were tested. One round of 75mm high explosive was detonated on the front of the cupola at a 0.4 inches above the roof. The roof plate was severely cracked over an area of 2 feet and 9 inches times 2 feet 6 inches. And force inward 2.5 inches at a 0.4 inches in front of the cupola. Blast would have entered the turret. Yes, this refers to the rooftop, yet the armor thickness of the hull roof was the same, and additionally, since the hatches reduced the structural integrity of the area, it was likely that the turret roof plate was better in resisting damage than the hull roof. Additionally, we need to consider the following German report about the early Panther. The new hatch design caused problems, especially for the driver and radio operator. When hit, the hatch cover jams and can't be opened. If the Panther was to catch on fire, in many cases the driver and radio operator couldn't evacuate. In action, crews don't close the hatches and accept the loss of protection so that they can still quickly evacuate if a fire occurs. Be aware that is based on an early report. As such, the reference to the new hatch design is regarding the Panzer 3 and 4. Additionally, since this was reported with an early model, this problem might have been fixed. Yet at the same time, only the Panther G had a hatch design that opened in a different way. Note that the first major production run of the Panther G was completed in April 1944. Yet back to the British reports. This time about armor-piercing projectiles. Having regard to the above factors, therefore, frontal attack by our 6-pounder, 75mm and 17-pounder weapons would normally be expected to be ineffective. But as stressed in this report, a strike either by a 6-pounder, 75mm or 17-pounder below the transverse center line of the gun mantlet is, on account of the design adapted, likely to be deflected through the relatively thin hull roof, thus causing damage and casualties. Here you can see the Panther of the Panzermuseum Munster. How relatively thin the top armor of the Panther is, particularly if you look at the massive mantlet. Since the top armor for the hull and turret was the same, here you get a better view at the MHN Dresden's turret. How thin the top armor is compared even to the rather weak side armor, but of course the frontal armor is far thicker. Note that this turret is in the depot. And sorry that I did not bring a banana for scale, but in former East Germany that might be a bit inappropriate. Anyway, this short trap, although known for a long time, was only addressed during the production run of the G-series Panther, when in September 1944 a chin mantlet was added to the turret. Although be aware that this conversion was gradual and even at the end of the war, some Panthers were shipped without that addition to the turret. Next, we look at the Sobat pamphlet from 1943 called Vulnerable Parts of the German Panther Tank and Methods of Combat Against It from the Directorate of Armored and Mechanized Forces of the Red Army. It contained a two-page graphic showing the weak spots and various weapons that could be used against specific parts. The weapons listed are rifles, anti-tank rifles like the PTRD and PTRS. For more information on them, check out this video. Then all types of Soviet guns ranging from 45mm to 85mm, Molotov cocktails, and anti-tank hand grenades like the RPG-43. So let us take a look. Rifle and anti-tank rifle fire should be directed against the observation ports of the commander's cupola, as well as the gun. Similarly, all other guns of any caliber should be directed against those parts as well. Up to a range of 600 meters, anti-tank rifle fire should be directed against the sprocket wheel. Next are anti-tank hand grenades. These should be directed against the cupola, the turret roof, the hatches of the driver and radio man, the hatch at the rear of the turret, and the exhaust fans on the engine deck. Meanwhile, Molotov cocktails should be targeted against the air intakes. In terms of guns and anti-tank guns, they are listed armor-piercing and high-explosive shots of all calibers, armor-piercing solid shots, armor-piercing shots with high-explosive filler, and 45mm armor-piercing subcaliber shots. Note that the second and third indicated either the caliber 57 and 85mm, so referring to the SIS-2 anti-tank gun and the 85mm anti-tank gun and or the D5S in the SU-85. First off, the 45mm subcaliber shots. These were noted with a maximum range of 500 meters and directed against the side of the turret and the side of the hull. Specifically at the second armor skirt from behind with the note, hit the fuel tanks. Next is armor piercing with high explosive filler. Here it is noted that all calibers should be directed at the hatch at the back of the turret. Additionally, the other target was the gun mantlet, where the barrel and mantlet connected. At least if I'm not mistaken. There are several possibilities here. Either the actual target was the machine gun port in the mantlet, an observation device, or maybe the shot should not destroy but damage the gun or its sight calibration. For the caliber 57, the machine gun port of the radio man is marked up to a range of 500 meters. The back of the hull to a range of 1000 meters. Finally, the side of the turret up to a range of 1500 meters. The 85mm is indicated only one time from the front against the driver's port with a range of up to 1000 meters. Next is a solid armor-piercing shot. Here the target is two times the frontal skirt, one time 1000 meters for all calibers, and for the 85mm gun also for 1500 meters. Finally, high explosive and armor-piercing shots of all calibers should be directed at the track wheels, the idler wheel, and the tracks. Big thank you here to Peter from Tankarchives for helping out with the translation and some questions. We also have a British report with some lessons learned from Normandy, although it seems that they engaged rather inexperienced German troops. We will also contrast some parts that match or mismatch a German report, although from the Eastern Front. Lessons learned from this action in which the squadron knocked out 8 Panthers for the loss of 3 of our tanks were as follows. A. By observing with field glasses, we are able to see enemy tanks before they could see us. On no occasion have enemy tank commanders been seen to use binoculars. They use their cupola for observation. Hence, they did not know the direction from which they are hit and seem to lose their nerve. This seems rather odd, likely inexperienced troops, since the Germans stressed the importance of observation and reconnaissance. To quote a German report of a Panther battalion, it must be avoided at all costs to give the enemy an opportunity to take the Panther under fire at shorter range. For this purpose, a widely advanced combat reconnaissance is necessary. To continue with the British report, B. Crews generally do not appear to be well trained. Their Panther tanks are as fast as the Sherman, but they move slowly, sometimes in fits and starts, and are slow to traverse the gun. On the occasion when heavily shelled by high explosive from our 75mm guns, the crew were seen to bail out. C. To be certain of a good brew-up, follow up AP with an immediate high explosive. This usually brings about a satisfactory result. The next part is particularly interesting because it matches the German report. E. Do not engage Panthers when they are obviously out of 75mm range, no matter how tempting they appear. They are nearly always supported by Tigers or Panthers in concealed positions and are clearly put out to draw fire. Meanwhile, the German report, it has proved practical at a distance of 1000 to 1200 meter to send a platoon of Panzerkampfwagen Panther to be sent ahead, which is to draw out enemy fire at an early stage, thus giving the mass of guns the opportunity to open fire at a distance. Finally, the British report notes, F. The old rule of fire and move has proved to be the best. Avoid remaining in the same position when once you have fired. Move to another position unless you have been certain you have been unobserved. German crews we have fought against up to now appear to have no knowledge of fire and move. When hit, they seem to be uncertain what their next action should be. With a little patience, the tank will move, and this is the time, as soon as he turns his flank, to pack the lethal punch. This again sounds like untrained troops. It sounds more like these German troops panicked and retreated in a haste instead of backing up in reverse gear and only turning once out of sight. Then again, it is hard to tell what the situation was. As far as I know, one German veteran described a similar scenario, where an inexperienced crew exposed its flank in such a situation. And generally turning a Panther sideways while being under fire seems a very bad idea. Well, as you have seen, there are many ways to skin a cat, even if the cat is a heavy armored beast with a long barreled 75mm gun. Big thank you to Peter Samsonov from Tank Archives for helping out with the translation of the old pamphlet. Thank you to Jens Wehner and Roman Töppel for answering some questions, and to Andrew for reviewing the script. And of course, a big thank you to the Military History Museum of the Bundeswehr in Dresden and the Panzermuseum Munster for inviting me. Special thanks to all my supporters for making trips to the museums and to military archives possible. As always, sources are in the description. Thank you for watching and see you next time.